I'm not sure where to start. It almost feels impossible. The past meets with the present, fighting for space. Demanding attention, to be heard, to be seen. A lifetime worth of memories. Depending on where we're at in life, our perception of a memory changes. How do you know which version is the truth? I used to think I knew exactly who you were. The idea of you captured perfectly in my mind. I told myself you had your own ways of showing you cared. Ways I didn't understand until I was much older. Despite our best efforts, life is unpredictable. Doesn't care who you are, what you're doing, or what you have planned. Things begin, and sometimes, when you least expect it, things end. It's hard not to think about how time has changed the memory of you. How it will continue to change, to shift, until I'm left with a version I've created in my head. Everything still looks the same. I can't tell if that's comforting or not. I don't like looking at the front porch and not seeing you there. You came here to relax, to catch your breath, to be at peace. Maybe if I stay a little longer, I'll feel it too. We all went hiking sometimes. You packed the lunch, Dad mapped the trail. I was in charge of pointing out all the good rocks and trees. But I wanted to wander and see where the trees took me. I can see why you liked being outside, sitting here listening to the branches dance against the breeze, the smell of coffee brewing. Dad usually brought you a cup. This yard holds a lot of memories. Watching you pull weeds, spraying grass with the hose, I'd beg you to splash me with water during the summer and you'd sigh real big. But you would. Daydreaming became as normal as breathing, imagining made-up places and letting my mind wander. The outdoors fed my curiosity. I called out shapes I saw in the clouds. I followed ants back to their home. I pulled up weeds thinking they were flowers and made crowns. Do we remember things differently? What story did your memories tell? The big oak tree is where I thrived. I climbed it so many times, my knees were always scratched up. And then one day, I fell. I wasn't hurt, just scared. I ran to you for comfort, crying. You frowned and told me it was my fault for climbing too high. You watched me carefully for the next few days. Had Dad cut down weak branches. The restaurant called. It's easy to forget that the world keeps moving. Cleaning out the house shouldn't take long. How did I lose touch with what was important? How did you? I ask as if you'd have the answer. I'll never know. How do you choose what's most important? It all looks untouched, but I feel so different. Like a stranger that doesn't belong. Shoes off, slippers on. But I'd always forget. It was the first thing you'd ask me to do when we came home. Like a ritual meant to be followed without question. Even now, I find it hard to remember. Was it calming? The ritual of it all? Every week, like clockwork, you had us dressed and on time. You had the piano since before I was born. You taught yourself to play as a kid, but fell out of it with age. When I started showing interest, you began to give me lessons. It became hard to separate your wants from my own, my hobbies and yours. I didn't even know what I wanted. It was safer to listen. You tried to teach me about my culture from an early age, and sometimes it meant skipping out on time with friends. The food you ate, the language you spoke, they were parts of you that you felt needed to be passed on. We had color-coded dishes. Dad's rice bowl was blue, yours was pink, mine was yellow. You said I wasn't allowed up from the table until I learned how to use chopsticks. Workbooks were left unopened, and any attempt to speak in your native tongue was met by English. You tried so hard, and I didn't budge. Things had to be perfect. Unlike people, glass can be polished. Spaces can be controlled the way we like. Eventually, we stopped speaking Japanese in the house. It didn't bother me much when I was young. I never considered what that loss meant to you. I don't remember much from that day. Maybe that's on purpose. I was pulled to shore, coughing, crying. Dad called for a lifeguard. You told me I should have listened. From then on, I told myself that if I stayed in line, I'd be safe. I could control my own actions, my behaviors. Things would be okay. For years and years, I've listened. Settled into what you tried to teach me. It became rhythmic, comforting. Back straight, arms taut, eyes straight ahead. There's comfort in safety, in routine. Relax your shoulders. Smile. Stop tapping your foot. The gift was thoughtful. It showed how proud you two were, and it eased my nerves about performing. I knew work kept you busy. I tried not to expect anything. The chances were slim, but I found myself hoping, desperate for you to show. But eventually, I had to go on without you. How could you not make the time? I don't know. I never asked. Maybe some things are better left alone. Why did I come here? There's so much I've forgotten, all for good reason. I'm here now. I made the time. I had to. There was no one else. I didn't come here to sort through your things and pack up your life. Who would? I've only got so much space. You liked documenting holidays and sending pictures back home. We all dressed nicely, posed with our shoulders back. If Dad tried pulling a face, you'd hit him gently and we'd start again. You pushed me to get good grades because you knew I was smart. But in my mind, I never knew if I was performing up to your standards. I think that almost made it worse. I wanted a reaction. I wanted your explicit approval. I was desperate for praise. If you didn't tell me you were proud, it meant there wasn't anything to celebrate. I remember watching those big monster movies with him as a kid. I was probably too young, but Dad was really into them. I think that's where my fear of moths came from. of all my memories with Dad. Listening to music on the front porch has to be my favorite. I think that's where I got my good taste in music. He even let me try a sip of beer when I was still a kid. "Don't tell your mother," he'd say. "You brought this back for me after a work trip. You said I would fill one eye in now, set a goal, and fill in the other after I completed it. At the time, it made sense to focus on college." Dad was pretty frugal. I guess it was a trait you both shared. He said he could build a playset instead of buying one. I was his helper. I think I did more damage than anything else, but I brought him lemonade, and that seemed to make up for it. Dad always had us sit together whenever you weren't working late. It was a nice routine, something to look forward to. I liked it when everyone was around. We fell into our roles. You cooked, I set the table, Dad did the dishes. Sometimes you'd be away at work for days at a time. Dad and I managed. When the frozen dinners and takeout got old, I started getting more adventurous in the kitchen. Eventually, I took over most of the kitchen duties. You didn't always have the time, and I was good at it when I wasn't making mistakes. Dad was always there to help fix them. We had plans to go to Japan before I went to college. I hadn't been back since I was a kid. I spent an entire summer there with my cousins. We caught beetles and watched fireworks and ate watermelon on the roof. It would be a break for everyone, especially you. A second to catch your breath and enjoy the moment. To rediscover what it meant to be carefree. Everyone was excited, but I had to get accepted first. No one in the family ever had the chance to go to college, so this was big for us. Things were falling into place. Then everything stopped. And suddenly I was 7 again. It was the start of summer. Dad and I were outside at night looking for ghosts. He let me hold the flashlight in case he got scared. Maybe I would be a ghost hunter. And then I was 16. He drank beers on the front porch. The record player was loud enough for him to hear from out there. I sat and listened to him talk about the music. Sometimes we sat in silence and stared out at the sky. The pain in my chest hurt. How could I feel so much and so little at the same time? We didn't know what to do. We handled it in different ways. Things went back to normal. Routines started up again. I was angry. I wondered why you looked okay. I didn't know what to make of you. You were so stoic in the wake of his death, and it confused me. Where was the pain? Why was I going through it alone? I still don't have it figured out. I'm stumbling through it, trying to understand. I know now that grief is constant and always changing. It was overwhelming. I was on autopilot, going through the motions. At some point, I hit a wall. I didn't understand what it was at the time, but I couldn't move past it. I knew education was important to you and Dad, but my heart wasn't in it. I was distracted, confused, angry. Not even a year went by before I dropped out. Time passed by while my body continued without me. I avoided your calls. I couldn't tell you I left school. It wasn't any of your business. The weight in my chest grew heavier. Every move was exhausting. When I try to remember this time in my life, it's like there's pieces missing, gaps where there shouldn't be. I found a dishwashing job a while after. I figured I needed something to do, something to focus my energy on. Anything was better than nothing. To my surprise, I liked it. It felt good knowing my work helped the kitchen. One day, I was asked to step on the line because we were short-staffed. It didn't take long to realize I was good at it. Being in a completely new kitchen was freeing. I got to create my own identity, my own rules. Who was I, independent of you? Figuring out my place was equal parts exciting and confusing. A new challenge to be faced alone. I made so many good memories in this kitchen. You taught me how to hold a knife so I wouldn't cut myself. You gave me confidence in the kitchen. It became muscle memory, like second nature, almost as easy as breathing. There I was, 6 years old again, trying my best to help you without getting in your way. My first day of jumping on the line, I knew this is what I wanted to do. I practiced at home, put what you taught me to use. The confidence you instilled reminded me I wasn't bad at this. I would get better fast. Food was so fun when I was a kid, finding new flavors and textures. An adventure we took together. My excitement only grew as I got older. I began to explore the possibilities and found myself happy, wanting more. It felt good, finding that fire again. It was missing for a long time. You were very particular about the process of cooking. There wasn't room for creativity. A recipe had to be followed. The gyoza had to be folded a certain way. That mindset, that need for perfection, is what I retained. Keep a tidy workstation and kitchen, clean as you go. When I got older, you started working more. We spent less time cooking together, but I was determined to keep it up. Into my 20s, this drive for perfection became everything. It consumed me. It gave me a sense of control. After many late nights, being the last in the kitchen, That dedication took me to the top. As I opened each cabinet, clearing out the contents, everything started to hit me. My hard work paid off. I was the one giving orders, creating dishes, curating entire menus. I had control and creativity to do what I wanted. People started to notice. They came from everywhere. Critics started talking about us. The more we got noticed, the harder I worked. The rush was amazing. I was so busy. It left little time for you. Sometimes we'd grab lunch, but I thought that I needed to show you the result of all my hard work, to show you what I built for myself. That led to finding the right place to open my own restaurant, to be my own boss. And then, a call. None of it mattered anymore. I have this knowledge of our culture, of everything you taught me. What do I do with it all? It's intimidating. Is this how you felt too, when you were teaching me? Were you worried about losing yourself? That no one would remember what your mother taught you? I'm not sure I'm ready to go through your things. It doesn't feel right, intruding on your space like this. You worked a lot. At one point, it seemed like your job took over the life you built. Your work followed you home and never left. It became part of our family dynamic, creeping into weekends or late nights after dinner. Sometimes I'd still be awake when she came home late at night. I'd hear the door open and shut, and her quiet footsteps creep past my bedroom. What did you want out of it? The long hours, the hard work away from home? What did it give you? Maybe it was the routine. Each day was different, but there were always elements that could be controlled, especially at home. Even after Dad died, you stuck to this pattern. We talked about going to Japan together. It had been a long time since we'd gone back. It'd be different this time. We'd create new memories as adults. I can't believe you actually bought plane tickets. But I was scared of leaving my work behind. Everything would fall apart if I left. I tried to tell you, and you just nodded. Sometimes I'd forget holidays. It was late into the night before I'd call. If I called at all. I can't do it. The longer I'm here, the more I think about you. The what-ifs, the things I can't change about us. I created an idea of the kind of person you were, but I never stopped to ask if that was you. Time didn't fail us. I did. I need to go. All at once, I saw my future laid out in front of me. I'd fly back to open the restaurant. I'd achieve everything I hoped to accomplish. Years would pass, and I'd be there, night after night. I'd come home late one night and wonder how things could have been different. Nothing I've accomplished will matter in the end if I run away from the loss of you. It's not too late. Are these yours? How did I never know? What other parts of your life was I oblivious about? Who were you when I wasn't watching? When you were all alone? I wish I could have known you more as a person. It's hard to picture the leap you took to get here. One of the biggest decisions of your life. I bet it was exciting and terrifying. You set foot here and tried to find solid ground so I would have my footing when I ventured on my own. I didn't think you actually kept these. Why do we keep things from each other? The pride we felt, the love we held. Thought you didn't care, but you did. I couldn't see it at the time. It was hard on you when I left. I was too absorbed in myself to notice. You used to wear this all the time. A gift from Dad, I think. You loved it. You wore it a lot, especially on business. You wanted me to have it after Dad died, but I didn't want it. It was too soon. I didn't want anything that reminded me of him. It took a long time to understand that it was your way of reaching out, of helping me keep a part of him.
He tore you apart too, but you managed to hide it under the surface.
Thank you.
You were trying to be strong. For both of us. It may be too late to make things right with you, but I need to finish this out. It's the least I can do. I've been running away from the things I can't control my entire life. Parts of my life feel like they've been frozen in time, waiting to be played over and over again in my mind. I'm still that little kid. The seagulls are still flying overhead. I can still taste the salt water in my mouth. I'm 13 again and upset you missed that night. You tried to explain yourself, but I wouldn't listen. I couldn't. I can still see myself on that bench. I felt everything and nothing all at once. I didn't know how to handle Dad being gone. I looked to you as my guide to grief, but you were stoic. It confused me, angered me, left a grudge. When I got news you were gone, it was like my body moved without me. I left the phone and went back to work, like nothing had changed. I couldn't help but picture myself leaving. I wasn't ready to confront it. What does life look like when we come to terms with the past? How do I make that work? Maybe I'm not supposed to know. I decided to use those tickets. I'm hoping to get to know you better. Who you were. Where you came from. When I go back home, I'll have these pieces of my past waiting for me, reminders of the good and bad. But I'll also be carrying them with me, wherever I go, ingrained in my bones.